everybody. I'm going to discuss with you in this short video how to get arms and be granted arms in Scotland. I was delighted to be asked to do this and to share it on our YouTube channel. It's hopefully a series of short talks that will come from the Court of the Lord Lyon. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Dr. Joe Morrow and I'm the Lord Lyon King of Arms, with jurisdiction in Scotland and with those of Scottish descent. I know that you will want me to be fairly short in compass to try to explain to you what steps you have to take if you want to be granted Scottish arms. Let me then try to tell you how you can apply for arms in Scotland. The question of how you can apply and the supplementary question about how a decision is reached about a petitioner on the design of the arms are part and parcel of what I want to explain to you. Let me go back a little into the history. The Court of the Lord Lyon and the Office of Lord Lyon are governed by Scots law. It's my view that we are the last functioning heraldic court to be working under a state legal system. As Lord Lyon, I have the authority to grant arms, and that's given to me by the sovereign herself. The office is ancient and goes back into the Celtic period of Scottish history. But today, in this century and in the relevancy of our own time, I'm the head of the heraldic authority in Scotland. And it's for me to grant arms and design them and to record them into the public register of all arms and bearings of Scotland, which, by the way, in 2022 is 350 years old. So watch for the programme to celebrate that event. The process of granting arms starts with a lodging of a petition. Its validity is checked by the Lyon clerk, who's one of the officers to my court. And once all this sorted out and it seemed to be in order, it's passed to me as Lyon to see if I'm satisfied that the petitioner falls under my jurisdiction. In general terms, and this is not an exhaustive list, jurisdiction is established by obtaining an answer yes to the following questions. Is the petitioner of Scottish birth? Is this petitioner of Scottish parentage or ancestry? Is the petitioner resident in Scotland? And does the petitioner make a substantial contribution to Scottish life? Once jurisdiction has been established by Lyon, then another question must be answered, a question that's contained within the statutes that govern us. The question is, namely, is the petitioner a virtuous and well-deserving person? Now, I'm the sole judge of that. If these questions are answered in the affirmative, then we move to discuss the design of the arms themselves. As most of you will know, in general terms, the grant of arms consists of a shield, a mantle, a crest, and a motto. And we follow the Scottish design of arms, somewhat different in other jurisdictions, but obviously the Court of the Lord Lyon is about Scottish arms. Before the question of design is returned to, let me point out that there can only be one person at any one time can hold a particular coat of arms in Scots heraldry. There's no such thing as a family coat of arms. In Scots heraldry, there is one additional matter which I would draw to your attention, and that is we still have within our powers the penalties to charge for the misuse of arms or the adoption of arms in Scotland that have not been granted by the Lord Lyon. And I can explore this at a different time. Let me go back then to the question of design in Scots heraldry. And there are three basic principles. Number one, we follow the family name. What does this mean? For example, if you look at the slides that are available of the arms of the chief of the name of MacGregor, and the second one, which is the arms of one of his clansmen, then you can clearly see similarities based on the chief's arms, but there is a difference for the individual clansmen. To put it another way, the chief has the base arms and the clansman has a subsidiary arms differenced for him as an individual petitioner from that of his chief. So no family arms, they're arms to the individual and one set of arms to one individual. If you work your way through the public register of all arms and bearings in Scotland held in my office, then you will see the progression of the difference of arms with the same name. We have, as I've said, approximately 100 volumes going back to the 16th century till now that display the public following of arms in Scotland. And these grants are still continued today by the Lord Lyon. The second point I want to make, and the second principle, is that we personalize the arms around the individual. For example, again, turning to the concept of the chief of the name and arms of Hay, then it has a very simple Scottish style. The blazon for the chief's arms is argent, three in escutcheons gules. In simple language and in good colloquial Scots, this is a big white shield with three wee ones on it. And all of those who bear the name of Hay will have some designs, particularly that of the escutcheons gules, or the small shields of the red shields of the Hay arms. The third principle is there is an attempt in Scots heraldry to keep things simple. This is often called, in colloquial terms, the fridge magnet test. If you cannot recognize arms on a fridge magnet, then they maybe aren't the most simplest form of arms. Over the years I've been in the office, and I started on February 2014, I've seen a range of individuals, bodies, companies from diverse parts of Scottish life and from the living Scotland throughout the globe who've applied for arms and have attempted to follow these principles. Once I've designed the arms and established that they are clearly acceptable to the petitioner, and the whole issue of the discretion of the arms rests with me, then I sign a warrant in favour of the petitioner containing the instructions to the Lyon clerk to record the arms in the register. The warrant contains the blazon, which is used by the heraldic artist to prepare the letters pattern. The blazon is the international recognized language for heraldic art. Finally, when all of this is done and the artists have prepared on vellum the arms and the narration of the petitioner's background, the letters patent are ready for my signature and my seal. And as far as possible, it is my joy to be able to present personally to the petitioner their letters patent. The arms then become the property of the petitioner and can be passed down through the law of succession of arms. But that's another talk. I welcome then petitions from all parts of the diverse living Scotland to celebrate the heritage of heraldry as I see it and as we value it. It is said that the various colours, charges and shapes of arms make heraldry the garden of Scottish history. Why don't you think about taking a walk through that garden. Thank you for listening to me.